invisible, seeing the invisible. And the passage that I'm going to read, it's in Hebrews chapter 11. That's a chapter of faith. And it says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking for the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Now, this is our English translation, and most English translations say, seeing him who is invisible. I'm not saying it's not well translated, but most languages, like in French and other languages, they didn't put the word who, because in the original text, it's seeing the invisible, seeing the invisible. Now, I know it makes sense, seeing him who is invisible, but I don't like us to be limited, you know, just for a small thing that the interpreters of Scripture place there. Of course, it's seeing God who is invisible, but I want to talk today about not only about an invisible God that is present, but the possibility that we have to see into the spiritual world. The world around us is made of matter, and we look at all things around, and everything is material. So we see material things. We don't see spiritual things, even though some people say they've seen ghosts and they've seen all different kinds of things. And as Christians, we know that it is possible to actually see beings that naturally live in an invisible world. And we're going to talk about that also in Scripture. Now, have you ever heard about some books called, in Canada, they're called... Where's Waldo? Yeah, all right. In England, they're called Wally. But in Canada and States, it's Where's Waldo? All over the world is Wally. So where's Wally? I don't know if you can find Waldo over there. I'm not going to give you enough time probably to find Waldo. But what's Where's Waldo? This is a series of books by a British illustrator, Martin Hanford, and the book consists of double-page drawings or illustrations citing dozens or thousands, some thousands, no, but hundreds of people doing a variety of amusing things in different locations. And readers are challenged to find Wally or Waldo, and even in the group. There's even a theme park in Ontario. I believe it's in the city of Woodstock. There's a place, a park, a theme park, where you try to find Waldo over there. And it's really hard to find. The thing is, once you find Waldo in the book, I don't think you're going to read the book again, because it's no fun anymore. Now you know where Waldo is. Now you know where the character is hiding. And my question for you today is, where is God in your life? Because, you see, you can have so many things going on in your life, and you're trying to find God, like, you know, kids try to find Waldo over there, and you cannot find God, and you keep looking, and where's God, where's God, where's God in this situation? Maybe a situation of a disease or a separation in your family, things that are hard to face. There's troubles in our lifetime. There's situations in which you think, where is God in all this? And you're trying to find God. You know, it's just as a kid is trying to find Waldo. And it is easy to spot God once you receive the ability of seeing the invisible. You see, some people question even the existence of God because they cannot see God. And they say, well, God, if you're real, show up. And God can do it, but he chose to live in his realm, which is the realm of the invisible, the spiritual realm. That's where he chose to live. He created us in a different realm, which is inferior to the other one. You see, we're living here in this world, and one day, if we abide in God, and if we receive this call that he extended to all mankind, and some of us here said, yes, I want to have God in my life, one day we will pass from this world to his world. We will go from the visible world into the invisible world. And when we do so, we cross a way that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, opened for us. It was closed. It wasn't possible to pass that way. But he paved a new way. He opened a new way through his blood. And now we have access to the Father. And now we have this assurance that because of the shed blood of Jesus, we can not only know that we'll be there, but even here, we have the ability to see into the invisible. Just like Moses. Moses, he chose between wealth and being in Egypt and just living and living with the people of God. He chose between first world and third world, or fifth world or sixth world, because there were nomads in the desert with no place to be. So it was a really a difficult time, a difficult season, but the Bible says he remained firm as one who sees the one who is invisible, or one who sees the invisible world. Now, God does new things also during our lifetime, and some people cannot see the new things that God is doing. Why? Because those things sometimes are invisible. Now, Isaiah 43:18, it says, remember the former things, remember not the former things, remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? Listen, this is God asking and questioning his people. And he's mentioning very important topics here. One, he's saying, do not remember the things of old if you want to possess the things of new. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm excited when I have a new thing. I was enjoying seeing Sandra playing with the iPhone 5 yesterday, and I wanted to play with it also. It's a new thing, and I have the 4, but I can't wait for Christmas or for my birthday to get the 5. Because I enjoy new things. It's so good to have new things. Sometimes we cannot have new things. Listen, the Bible is talking about the new things that God does, but we can relate to new things. Don't you like to buy a new dress, ladies? Guys, don't you like to get a new car? Wow, this is so good, yeah? So we enjoy new things. We enjoy new things. Hallelujah. Now, in order to possess the new things that God has for us, those new things are invisible. The things of the past, the old things, we already went through those things. So they were made visible. They happened. So it's things that happen. The things in the future, they didn't happen yet. So it's in the realm of the invisible. Everything that is in the future, it's in the realm of the invisible. Listen, God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So now, because he is the same, and because he moves through time and eternity, to him, the new things are not new as they are for us. To God, all things are things, because he moves through the past, the present, and the future. But he's saying, and he's telling you today, as he told the people of Israel, I'm doing a new thing. Don't you perceive it? Can't you see I'm doing a new thing? Notice it doesn't say, I will do a new thing. It doesn't say, I did a new thing. But God says, I am doing a new thing. He doesn't say, I'm going to do a new thing. He says, I am doing a new thing. So the new things of God, the things that we think are the future, God is saying, I'm doing them now. Let me just exemplify this. You know that by faith, we can be healed. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says that by the stripes of Jesus, by his stripes, we are healed. It doesn't say we're going to be healed in the future. It says we are now, because God moves through time, but he moves in the present. And he wants us to respond in the present. He wants us to react in the present. What is God doing in your life right now? What is that you want God to do in your life? What do you need from the Lord? And you might say, well, I like that God will do this in my life. And you project the future. Say, I would like to have this thing. And I'd like to move to that place. And I'd like to have that job. And I'd like to have this. And we see these things as possibilities. But God sees the reality of our life as a present thing. And He says, I am doing a new thing now. You need to perceive it. But notice what it says. In order to possess the things of you, you need to leave the past behind. Okay. Now, you can see spiritual things with or without knowledge. So we're talking about the invisible world and how to see the invisible. Let's read this scripture in Hebrews chapter 13, verses 1 and 2. Now, the scripture says, brotherly love must continue. How many of you love people around you? Okay, just tell the person next to you, I love you in the Lord. And some you love, not in the Lord and in the flesh too. All right. Now verse 2 says, do not neglect hospitality, because through it some have entertained angels without knowing it. Oh, that's awesome. I don't know if there's any angel here. So when someone comes to church for the first time, I think you're maybe an angel. I don't know. I'm just kidding. But we never know. When someone shows up, you know, they show up in church. You know, angels show up in church. They don't understand very well what's going on. They marvel. But they show up in church. They show up in spirit. But certain times, angels can be manifested in the natural world. Amen. And the scripture shows time after time after time, many episodes, many women and men that have encounters with angels. And this is why here, the New Testament, it says, don't neglect being hospitality. Hospitality is the way we treat others. We need to treat others with respect, with love in the Lord, showing the glory of God in our lives. And so we cannot neglect. When a thing is neglected, you know, it's like a house that needs painting. It's like a house full of mold. And it looks ugly and it's neglected. It's a place where instead of having a lawn, it has a jungle at the front. I don't know if there's some of your neighbors that have a jungle that you need to have a katana to cut through the grass and to arrive to the house. But let me tell you that when things are neglected, they don't look like new. So our life cannot be neglected. And some people, they neglect their spiritual life. Now, let me give an example of this from the Old Testament. And it says in 2 Kings 6, the prophet's attendant, which was a servant, got up early in the morning. When he went outside, there was an army surrounding the city, along with horses and chariots. And he said to Elisha, oh no, my master, what will we do? So here's the situation. The city is surrounded. The enemies came. And everybody is doing their own stuff, their own affairs. And here's the servant of the prophet, Elisha, goes outside. He looks into the armies and says, oh no! Oh my God! What are we going to do? And he replied, don't be afraid, for our side outnumbers them. And this didn't make sense. Then on verse 17, it says, then Elisha prayed, oh Lord, open his eyes so he can see. The Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw the hill was full of horses and chariots of fire around Elisha. Amen. Now, this has nothing to do with the movie Chariots of Fire. Awesome movie. You know, guys running in shorts. Awesome. But this has nothing to do with Chariots of Fire. These are the real Chariots of Fire, the ones in the Bible. All right? And what happened here is that in the natural, there was a huge army and there was a city surrounded by enemies about to fall. But in the spirit, something was happening. The armies of the Lord were there. You see, sometimes we pray for Israel, for the peace of Israel. And I still remember I was born during the Six-Day War between Israel and Egypt. And it seems that they want to repeat the same thing. It seems that they neglected to study history because the armies of Israel were way smaller. But they reported when they were attacking with airplanes, they saw just a huge airplanes. a whole cloud of airplanes attacking the Egyptian forces. And in 6 days, a tiny nation defeated the most powerful army in Africa. That was awesome. That was awesome. And it wasn't the Israeli Air Force that did so. It was the Chariots of Fire. You see, when God needs to manifest His power, He will. When God needs to protect His people, He will. And He's the God of Israel, and He's the God of Isaac, He's the God of Abraham, He's the God of Moses, He's the God of Elijah, and you know, guess what? He's our God. And in Christ, we were made His children. So we are at the same level. We need to have our eyes open to understand that greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. By other words, when Satan was in heaven, Satan was named Lucifer, and he was a cherub, he was an angel. He was in charge of praise and worship in heaven. And he was just praising the Lord day and night. And he enjoyed worship so much, he thought he was so awesome, because the Lord created him with the musical instruments built in. You see, we can sing, but he can make music with his own body. So he's a very special angel. So Lucifer thought, I'm so awesome. So instead of all these angels worshiping the Lord, why don't they worship me? And he made one third of the angels to fall into sin, and they were cast out of heaven. One third, but two thirds still remain with the Lord. Amen? So there's always a group of beings that remains faithful to the Lord. And when we remain faithful to the Lord, we will see great things. So probably you're going through some situations and you say, where's God? You need to do the same prayer. Lord, open my eyes. Amen? Sometimes we sing the song, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. That's what it means. It's based on this scripture. And you think, the eyes of my heart, I don't have an eye in my heart. You know, the eyes are in my face, not in my heart. but the Lord can open those spiritual eyes so you can see. So, that young man's servant eyes were open to see the armies of the Lord because of a simple prayer. Now, you can ask the Lord to give you sensitiveness, awareness, and discernment in order to see the invisible. Those are gifts of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can give you this gift. And when the situation seems complicated, guess what? God is on your side. God is on your side. And maybe you're seeing, you know, that the armies are there, but the armies of the Lord are on top. And the chariots of fire, they're going to destroy by fire all those armies of the enemy. My last point, seeing by faith. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 18, it says, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Well, this is really deep. And I would like just, you know, to dissect this and to try to share with you. Every child of God has two sets of ears and two sets of eyes. We have the natural set that we are born with, and we have a spiritual set that we've been given upon being born again. Amen. So when you're born again, when you give your life to the Lord, when you accept what Jesus Christ did for you, you are born again. And guess what happens? Now you have a different set of eyes and a different set of ears. And I make proof of this because before I came to the Lord, I read the whole Bible. A Jesuit priest gave me the Bible and said, young man, here's the answer for your life. I believe you. And I just read the whole book. It was boring, but I decided I'm going to read it all. It was such a boring book, the Bible, for me. Especially, you know, those genealogies and the Leviticus and all those sacrifices. And I read unbelievable things, horrible things. And I couldn't understand those things. And I read the Bible, put it on the shelf. And I thought it was interesting, but it didn't change my life at all. But guess what? A seed remained in my heart. And one day I entered into an evangelical church and I heard the message of the gospel. I heard John 3:16 that says that God so loved the world that sent His only begotten Son, so whoever believes in Him shall not perish but will have everlasting life. And I guess that verse was already built in me. And it sparked, it made light. I gave my life to the Lord. I asked for forgiveness of my sins. Guess what happened? Now I started to read the Bible again, and the book was alive. Yes. I mean alive. And I will come to church and God will speak to me and the preacher will say things and I will say, how does he know that? That's just for me. You know, how does he know that I'm going through these things? And I felt the Holy Spirit talking to me, and the more I read the Bible, the more alive it was. Why? Because now the set of spiritual eyes and spiritual ears were open. You know, some Christians have them open and then they let spiritual blindness to come and cover their eyes. That's a different preaching. But natural eyes and ears don't always tell the truth. You see, sometimes we see things and we are deceived. Our own heart is deceiving. So we see situations and we can be completely deceived. Sometimes people around us, they see what's happening, but we can't, because our eyes can deceive us. But you know what? When we trust in God, He will open our eyes to see the truth. So we need to pray always, Lord, show me the truth about the situations. Show me the truth about myself. Now, do you believe in God?
Amen.
If you believe in God, you have received spiritual sight that you, will allow you to believe beyond what you see. That's why we do not, it says, we do not look at things which are seen, but the things which are not seen, or the invisible things. See the invisible. You can see the invisible. You just need to focus on the spiritual things. And you need to overcome your own unbelief. Unbelief will bring spiritual blindness. See, there's many people, they receive the message of the gospel, but they are unbelievers. There's many people in the church that need to be saved. In fact, I think the majority of churches, they have a vast number of people that are unbelievers, in the sense that they don't have their eyes straight to see the invisible. They only see the natural. And in the natural, they do judgments. They murmur, they criticize, they do all sorts of things because they're not able to overcome unbelief. Now, Jesus in John chapter 20, he had an encounter with the disciples. He went to the cross, he paid the price, he went to heaven, and he returned to earth. And he showed himself to the disciples. And on verse 25, it says that the disciples gathered and told one of them called James, "We have seen the Lord." He wasn't there. You see, they were gathered together, and the Lord appeared with a glorified body. He appeared to them, and they told James, and he replied, "Unless I see the wounds from the nails in his hands, and I put my finger into the wounds from the nails, and I put my hand into his side, I will never believe it." I will what? I will never believe it. Now, this is not a statement of faith. And then it says 8 days later, the disciples were again together in the house and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and examine my hands. Extend your hand, put it here into my side, and do not continue in your unbelief, but believe." And Thomas replied to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are the people who have not seen and yet have believed." Woo! You know what, folks? You're blessed. It's not me saying, it's Jesus.
Yes.
Here's Thomas. "Oh, I won't believe it. I will never believe it. I need to touch. I need to see. I need to see, you know, the hole of the nail. I need to put my finger there. And I want to put my hand into the side that was pierced, because I've seen, and I want proof. I want material proof." I don't know if Thomas came to church. These guys with another name, if you have, are in the same attitude, and you say, "I believe in God. If I'll see God face to face, I need to touch Him. You know, I need to pull His beard. I need to do something." Some people are like this, they're unbelievers. They're unbelievers. But God said, "Now you believe." God answered. Jesus actually answered that request. It doesn't mean that He's going to do the same thing with us. But God says that the people that believe without seeing are blessed. Now, you want to be blessed? You want to be considered blessed? Start training your spiritual eyes. and start doing something special. Now,
here's a TV remote. This is just for guys.
Amen.
When we're in the house, the living room, this one stays with me. It's not because I want to be in control, but I like to push buttons. I love buttons. Anything with buttons, and now digital buttons are even better, because instead of having just a set of buttons, we can have screens that the buttons show. It's awesome. So here's the remote control, and you know how it works, right?
Yeah.
So there's a button, and there's something right here. And it looks like a little bulb, but it's not a bulb. It's called an infrared transmitter. And so when you point it to the TV, or to the VCR, or the DVD player, there's no more VCRs, you'll see that at the front of the device, usually it's hidden now, but there's a section which is the receiver for the infrared. It's like the eye of the receiver. So the remote will do amazing things. I wish this will work with people. I don't know if you watched that comedy. Yeah, I don't know if it's Adam Sandler or whatever. Yeah. That he has a remote. I wish that would work with people. You know, if I was tired of someone, you know, talking to me, I'll say, okay, change the channel. Now, you see that there's a little thing in the front of the device, and you need to point it there. I know the new ones, you can even point to the wall, and you know, I don't know how they do it, but it will ricochet on the walls and it will get there. Now, when you look at the back of the remote control, you see this little panel here? There are some batteries, okay? They give power to the remote control. And I've learned something. When my kids need the batteries for their games, guess what happens? The remote is the first one to suffer. And then I grab the remote, and I start to say, stupid TV. Come on. What's going on? And I shake it, and I try to do all things, and then I remember, this is a big light, so let's see what happened here. And there's no power. Okay? Now, why am I telling you this? Because in order to see the invisible, and in order to activate invisible forces, we need to have the power of God in us.
Amen?
Amen? And maybe nobody else will see, you know, the infrared light, but there's some kind of light that comes out of here. It's invisible. Look, can you see anything? You can't. But I'm pushing the button. Believe me, it's something is going off here. It's invisible. You cannot see it, but we'll achieve a result. Now, our prayers need to be directed to God. You know, it's not like the new remotes that you direct the prayers and you pray to Mary or you pray to you know, this saint or that saint and you get to God. That doesn't work. You point it to God the Father. You need to have the power of God. And like seeing the invisible, you ask. You say, Lord, you know the problems I'm going through. I believe in victory. Just show me, Lord. Open my eyes. Let me see. And you know what? God will open the eyes so you can see the new things that he's already doing. He's not about to do. You know, he said in Mark 11, 24, therefore I say unto you, that what thing soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. So believe, when you pray, you believe that you have received. It's not that you're going to receive, you believe that you already received.
Amen.
And you know, do you sometimes wish you were a wiser person? Smarter, wiser? The Bible says that God is willing to give you wisdom if you ask. It's written there. It says God gives to everyone who asks. And so we can ask with a firm belief that God is going to answer the prayer. Just as the remote control sends an invisible light signal to the TV, others do not see your prayer either. But when it is sent with the power of faith, it's like a special light that God sees, and He responds in love to answer to your prayer. Isn't that awesome? So let us all stand. We're now going to send our infrared prayer to the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
When we pray, we're sending. Guess what? He's receiving. You need to learn where to point. Don't be like those people that do those prayers for 20 years and light candles for 20 years, nothing happens. That's insane, you know? Doing prayers and doing the, you know, prayers by a book for 20 years, nothing happens. And if you've been praying and you're not seeing the results, let me tell you, don't blame God. Don't blame God. It is time to forget about the past. Leave the glories of the past behind. The past is over. What God has for you is ahead of you.
Amen.
Not in the past. It's good to have memories. I love to see old pictures once in a while. I'm not every day sitting down with my wife and seeing the old pictures. Once in a while we do it. It's good to revisit the past once in a while, but I don't dwell there. I don't dwell in the glory of the past. You know, you see, it's very important what you did in the past, but in what concerns God, it's more important where you're going to finish.
Amen.
And how you're going to finish.
Amen.
So, just pick up your life. You need the batteries of the Holy Spirit, the power of God. Direct your prayers to the Lord. Push the right button. And you better be sure that something is about to happen.
Amen?
Amen? So, I'm going to pray now, general prayer for you, for you folks here, and for all the people that are listening on the internet and the ones that are watching through YouTube. Because I believe that you've listened to this message and there's a purpose. Because God wants to change your life. He doesn't want you to be, you know, like some people, they're trying to find Waldo in the page and they spend 2 hours over there. Praise God that, you know, I don't know if God gave me special sight. When I look at those books, it's like, here is Waldo. I find Waldo fast, and so I can find God fast in my life. We're all different. We're all different. So for you, it might take longer to find God. For you, it might take longer, you know, to understand these things. But the bottom line of this message, it's this. You need to put your eyes, set your eyes in the invisible things of God. Forget about the past, because God is telling you, I am doing a new thing. Can't you perceive it? Can't you see? I'm so excited because God is doing a lot of new things in my life. And in order for God to do new things, we need to die for some things in order to receive the new things that God has for us. And this is real in every aspect of life. So now we're going to pray. And I don't know what you're going through, but God knows. And I'm going to ask you just to do a simple prayer, just saying, Lord, here's my life.